Can I hear born again? Amen. Amen. Say to your neighbor, God will do you good. Why are you here? I didn't say you say that. I'm asking you a question. Why are you here? What is the purpose of the church service? And sometimes we don't understand this. You know what? I started a series a few weeks back, and God has been dealing with me like never before. My wife will attest. She was actually telling me, did you sleep last night? I said, I really did not sleep. Because God has been working in me. And what he's doing with me is great. That word super great is great. I just love it. I just love what he's doing with me. Keeping me awake, making me seek him. And the purpose is this, because there's nothing like the song we just sang, that we sang earlier on, that there's nothing we can do without him. So the question is, why are you here? What have you come to do? In fact, Jesus Christ asked similar questions to the disciples. He says, what did you go to the wilderness to behold? When they were going to see John, he says, who are you coming to see? Why are you here? Why are you in church? Why do we think about it? Why do we leave home every Sunday morning to come to church? Why? And that's one question we want to answer today. Our call is a profession. It's not a vocational job. The call or into ministry or the call into this kingdom is not a vocational job where you take break. It's a call. It's a profession. It's a profession. It's a call. That's why you are here. For those of us that are just coming because someone asked you to come, or you're following your parents to come, you must get it right. The reason why you are coming is because you need to be equipped to do the work of ministry. Why are you here? Just so that Pastor George can preach a message, and you can critique the message if it's good or if it's not good, if it's anointed or it's not anointed. That's not the reason why you're here. The reason why you're here is that you are equipped for the work of the ministry. That's why you are here. And the church have missed this. We have misplaced our priority. In fact, guess what? The greatest deception of Satan is not man committing sin. The greatest deception of Satan to the church is that the church no longer knows their priority. Why are you here? Why are you seated there? How come you come to church every Sunday? How come you tell people you are a Christian? Why are you a Christian? What is the reason? What is the reason? Why are you a Christian? Why are you here? Why did you leave your home today to come down here? It's not just to hear someone preach to you. It's not because you want to hear songs sang to you. The reason why you are here is that you are equipped to do the work of ministry. Anything short of that is a waste of time. And you're just wasting your life and wasting your life. Why are you here? This work is a work. The Bible talks about our call. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 to verse 10, I've not started my message. I've not started my message. I'll preach my message. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 to 10, I'm just telling you what the Spirit is actually prompting me to say to you guys. It's a prompting of the Spirit. For by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourself. It is the gift of God. It says, by grace you are saved. It is not of yourself. That means your salvation is not your will. It's that God has predestined you. The reason why you are here is not about you. It's about God. Most times we come to church, we always think it's about us. So when you don't feel it, you don't come. When you feel it, you come. No, it's not about you. The Bible says we are saved by grace, through faith. And it's not of ourselves, but it's the gift of God. That if it's the gift of God, then someone is in charge. And that someone is not you. It's not me. It's the one that has called us into this profession. Christianity is not just a thing you enter casually, like we've seen people do today in the church. They worship God when it's convenient, and they don't worship Him when it's not convenient. That's not Christianity. And that's the church that we're building today in this century. That's the church we see all over the place. Seekers-driven church, not Christ-driven church. Where we begin to tweak the message just to make sure it's palatable for you to hear and feel good. That's what the church has become. And Jesus says, that is not my mission. That is my purpose. My purpose for the church is that the church do the work of ministry. For by grace you are saved through faith. And it's not of yourself. It is the gift of God. Not of works. Lest any man should boast. It's not of works. It's not your righteousness that have saved you. So you cannot boast with it. It's everything about God. But why did He save you? He called you for a purpose. But 10. For you are what? His workmanship. Why did He save you? Because He wants to use you as a workmanship for His kingdom and for His purpose. Why are you here? You are here to be retooled, to do the work of ministry. You're not here to sit down and hear the word of God and hear someone preach to you or hear someone lead you in worship. That's not the reason why you're here. If that is the reason why you're here, you're missing it. The purpose of the church is to do the work of ministry. It says, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus Christ unto good works. Unto good works, we are His workmanship. Oh, the totality of me is to please Him and carry out His mission. That's why we're here. We're not here to hear another sermon. With all you have had, what have you done with everything you've had? The scripture records that we're going to be judged by the word we hear. The judgment of God for me is going to be based on what I've had Him say to me. The judgment of God is going to be based on my purpose in life. If I'm not able to accomplish that purpose, and what is the purpose? For we are created to become a workmanship, created in Christ. That's the purpose of God for our life. We become His workmanship, for we are His workmanship. We are the tool in His hand. The Old Testament will put it this way: you are my battle axe. With you, I will demolish kingdom. With you, I will grant salvation to many. You are my battle axe. You are the mirror that people will see, and they look through you, they see me. No wonder Jesus will say in John chapter 15, I am the vine and you are the branches. The branches can do nothing except they are attached to the branch, to the vine. And Jesus is the vine. So you are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. The question is, do you know what you are called to do? And if you know it, are you doing it? We live in a time, don't be deceived. You know what? A few weeks ago, I told Minister Christine, can you call them in New Hampshire that I want to go for a retreat? Guess what? And I was told, it snows in New Hampshire. The snow was just this way. And I looked at it and I got there and I said, God, why am I here? Why did I leave my home? Why did I leave the house? I have no agenda. I just drove to New Hampshire. No agenda. And God says, I called you here, not your agenda. Because I want to show to you what my desire is for my church. I want to tell you what my desire is. This is not the message I've been prepared for. That's why you're not seeing any slide. I want to tell you. Because my church have missed it. We are created. Give me that one. For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. It's workmanship. What are you walking? Are you walking your pleasure, or you are walking the will of God? Where are you walking? To fulfill your agenda, fulfill your purpose, or are you walking according to the will of God? For every man's walk will be put to judgment. Every man's walk will go through trial. Will your walk stand the trial? Will your walk stand the test? The only walk that can stand through the test is the one that has made himself the workmanship of our Lord God. 2 Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 6. Paul will write, he says, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold to eternal life. Lay hold to eternal life. Fight the good fight of faith. Why must you fight? Why is there a good fight? Because there's going to be every opposition to oppose you from becoming the workmanship of God. That's what Paul will say, fight. If you don't fight your way, everything is working against you when you are a Christian. If you really want to be a true Christian, everything is going to work against you. And that's why Paul says, because it's nature, things around you, your friends, and everything around you will be contrary to that thing that you believe. And so Paul says, fight that good fight of faith. Make sure you press in. Make sure you press in. Make sure you don't cave to the world and its pleasure. Make sure you are reminded you are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. And God is the one that determines that good works, not you and not me. Can I hear loud amen? Amen. This may as well be the message. And so Paul says, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life. How many of us are pursuing eternal life? There's life after death. How many of you are pursuing eternal life? What is your drive? The earth will pass away. This earth, like we know it, will pass away. In fact, it's right now passing away for some. And it's going to pass away one day. Are you pursuing eternal life? Where will you spend eternity? Have you considered it? Where will your soul be when you give up the last bread? Will you be before God? Because there's a place called heaven and there's also a place called hell. Where will you be? Where will you spend eternity? One of the things that guarantees your spending eternity with God is you becoming his workmanship created in Christ Jesus. That's what guarantees it. Nothing else. Our good works does not guarantee it. What guarantees is we becoming the workmanship of God. That's what guarantees it. And so when I got to the retreat ground, I was praying. I was just, and God, what? And God begins to rewind things to me and begins to show me things that I can't even explain to you guys here. That I'm sending you because you are getting into a season, because you've been preaching season, you are getting into a season in this church where the destiny of the people that you are leading will be defined. And it's going to be defined based on my will for their life. It's going to be defined based on their pursuit of me. Are you the workmanship created in Christ Jesus? Or are you just another Joe? Or another George? Or another Gloria? Or another Sam? Or another Uche? Who are you? It says, where unto thou also called as profess a good profession before many witness. Hebrews chapter 3, verse number 1. Whereby, holy brethren, partakers of heavenly call. Why are you here? You are here because you are a partaker of heavenly call. You have become is workmanship. God now is depending on you to do what he wants to do on planet Earth. You have become like Paul that says, it's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives in me. That the works and the things that I do is to glorify the one who has called me out of darkness into his glorious and marvelous light. Are you created in workmanship unto Christ? Or do you just live your life? We live in the very last days. The trumpet of God can sound at any time. And it will by and by. And the only thing that will count will be your relationship and your connectivity with the Holy Spirit and God himself. What will count? It's not time to play church. It's time to be the church of God. Can I hear a loud amen? Say, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of heavenly call, consider the apostles and the high priest of our profession, Jesus Christ. Consider him. What the scripture is saying, say, look at his life. Do what he did. Is the apostle and the high priest of our profession. It says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our profession. Looking unto Jesus, having a connection with Jesus Christ and his work. Why are you here? You're not here to just warm the bench. You are here to do the work of ministry. That's why he created you. You are created to do the work of ministry. The question now is, how connected are you with God and service? How important is this, the high priest of our profession, how important is his call to you or to your life? For so many of us, we have forgotten about Jesus. We only remember him when it's Sunday morning. Let's just come and worship someone. Can I hear that, amen? Can I hear born again, amen? Hebrews chapter 4, verse number 14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest, the same Jesus Christ, that is passed into heaven, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our profession, hold fast to that thing that he has called us to do or to be. Hold fast. That's what Paul is saying to us here. What are we holding fast? That we are his workmanship. We are his hand. We are to do the work of ministry. Hold fast. The scripture will record. Because by and by, the world is passing away like we know the world. It's never going to be like it used to be. Never. If you're expecting that, never, 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 never. We're approaching the climax of this grace era. Because, Pastor, how do you know that? You begin to see the falling away. The love of many becoming worse cold. Many now love material things. They pursue after material things. And Christ is no longer a priority. Can you imagine a Christian, those of us that call ourselves a Christian, just 2 hours a week they can't give to God. 2 hours. What a profession. What a great call. 2 hours for Sunday service, they can't even give. They're busy with their work. That will pass away. I was talking to your brother this morning. It blessed my heart. Here. You see there, he can't hear me. I said, brother, what's going on? I saw him doing text. This is his job. He said, no, I've told them I don't work on Sunday. I looked at him, I said, oh my God, this is exactly what God told me. Your profession, you don't take vacation on it. It's a call. You have a call on you. And God demands that you become his workmanship for good works. The question is, how much good works are you doing? Can God depend on you? Can God count on you? In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23, he said, let us hold fast this profession of our faith without wavering. Let's hold it fast without wavering, because the time will come that many's faith will be wavering. And that is what we see today in our world. People no longer serve God like they used to serve God. I know those that left Nigeria and they were dead, were so fervent in prayer and the things of God. Right now, they no longer can. And you ask them, they will tell you, my job. Now you tell them, you ask them, what's going on, my brother? No, this is tough. America is tough. What has changed? Nothing has changed. Guess what has changed? It's your commitment to the profession that you belong to. Those of us that left the island, we're fervent in our walking with God in the island, and we came to this country and we forgot that we were once saved. We were once committed to our husband, Jesus Christ. And we gave him everything. Come night vigil, we are there. Come evangelism, we are there. While we are home. But we came down here and we just said, kesira, kesira. Was that what daddy said? Kesira, kesira. Everything is good. By and by, we're in America now. Just relax. And we allow the wind to blow us away from this noble profession. What is your stand with God? The call is the call of ministry. You're not called to just listen to Pastor George week in, week out. You are called to do something for this kingdom. And that's what we want to discuss today. Can I hear loud amen? In the series of discussing the questions, the next question we're going to be treating today, we started by saying, where are thou? The second was, where are you going to? The third is so crucial. And I just want us to look at the third question. Now I'm in my message. Can you clap for Pastor George? Oh, God. Whilst I was talking to you, the time was going. So we're just going to see how we're going to go through this. Can I hear loud amen?
Amen.
A born again one.
Amen.
So this is part three of where art thou? And my subtitle is, where is thy brother? My subtitle is, where is thy brother? And I got that from Genesis chapter 4, verse number 9. What a coincidence. Chapter 3, verse 9. Chapter 4, verse 9. But in chapter 4, verse 9, there are two questions that is posed in chapter 4, verse number 9. Now, the story of Genesis chapter 4, it talks about two brothers called Cain and Abel, and we know them very well. The Bible says Cain is a farmer, and Abel is a shepherd. And in the process of time, they decided to offer sacrifice or offer offerings to the Lord. And Cain actually offered from his farm products. Cassava, cocoyam, and everything that he got from his farm. But Abel decided to offer his the fattest and the firstling. He gave God the best and the biggest. Why Abel gave God the best and the biggest, God actually had respect for the offerings of Abel. In fact, that tells me that not every offering that is given that is accepted. Trust me, not every offering we give that God accepts. God only accepts offering that comes from a clean hands, for a pure heart and a clean hands. Amen. It's good to do good. I've seen people that just decide to do good after they have committed atrocities. And they want to bribe God with their gift. And God says, no, I cannot be corrupt by gifts. And so Abel's gift was coming from a pure heart, from a sincere mind, a heart that loves God, a heart that wants to please God, a heart that had respect for God and everything that is God. And the Bible says in the course of time, when Abel's sacrifice was offered, was accepted by God, and God respected the sacrifice of Abel, and Cain's sacrifice was not respected. Cain was supposed to repent and says, God, what do I need? How do I improve me? But rather, Cain was jealous. Cain was envious. And eventually killed his brother. We know the story. And when he killed his brother, this is the question that God actually posed to Cain. Genesis chapter 4, verse number 9. And the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel thy brother? Where is Abel your brother? Where is thy brother? Does it mean that God did not know that Cain already killed Abel? No, God knew. But God is trying to send a message. God is trying to expose his mind to mankind, to me and you that is reading it today. And look at what Abel did. So look at what Cain did. Cain now answered God with a question. He must be a Nigerian. Because it's only Nigeria that answer question by question. Those of us that are from that country, can you wave at me? Am I right? Great place. You ask them a question, they throw back a question to you. I don't know of other places, but I'm from Nigeria, so I know Nigeria. Where are you going to? Why are you asking? Simple. Where are you going? Why are you asking? Did you see anything? Did I keep it for you? Was I there when you kept it? Question with question. So that was what the attitude of Cain is. And that's the attitude we have today in the church. Don't forget the scripture we read, Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 10, that we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for every good works. And God today is asking you and me, where is your brother? You may not be the one that have murdered him. You may not be the one that have sent him away. But God still holds you accountable for your brother. Can I hear a loud amen? Can I hear a loud amen? Amen. Can I hear a born again amen? Amen. So today we're looking at that question, so important. Where is thy brother? There are three questions that we need to examine as we begin to dive into this powerful, extraordinary question that God posed to Cain, and God is actually posing it to me and you today. The three questions we must consider, number one is, who is my brother? We must answer this question if we're going to be his workmanship created in Christ Jesus. Very important, we must answer this question. Who is my brother? The second question is, who is a keeper? And the third question is, are we commanded? Am I commanded to be my brother's keeper? So three key things we must answer today. Who is my brother? Number two is, who is a keeper of his brother? Number three is, am I commanded to be my brother's keeper? Now, in answering question number one, it says, who is my brother? And this is my answer. Your brother is anyone that is in need of your love and your care. It's not the one that you came from the same womb. It's not the one that comes from the same country like you are. It's not the one that shares the same color like you are. It's not the one that speaks the same language that you speak. But it's anyone that is in need of your love and your care. That is who your brother is. Can I hear loud amen? Pastor, how come your definition is wrong? Because Cain and Abel came from the same mother. Let me tell you what Jesus says. We're going to look at what Jesus says. How Jesus qualifies who your brother is or who your neighbor is. You're going to hear me interchange those words, neighbor and brother, but they're the same thing. For the sake of this message, they're just the same thing. Amen? Amen? So who is my brother? Is anyone I cross path with in life, that is my brother. Anyone that God allows your path to cross is your brother. Your co-worker is your brother. It's more brother to you than your blood brother. When we talk about neighbor and brotherhood, geographical location is key. Your proximity to a person is key in defining who a brother is when we talk about the definition of Christ Jesus. So the brother I see is the one close to me. is that your co-worker, that guy that works with you, that lady that works with you, that you are actually keeping an enmity with, that is your brother. Is that parent that the child goes to the same school with your child and you meet at your parents' teachers' meeting? That's your brother. Is that one that you meet in your gym? Is that one that you always cross path? God will always allow you guys to come in contact. That's your brother. Maybe your dry cleaner. That guy that works in the grocery store that you find that God will always make you have contact with him. Every time you come to the store, you begin to say, I don't know why every time I come to the store, I'm always in your register. No, it's not coincident. God says, that is your brother. You need to extend love and care to this one. There's nothing about God that is accidental. Everything about God is intentional and with purpose. And everything about God carries eternal value. The things of God does not end on planet Earth. Every time God brings you in contact with people, it's not only for planet Earth. Trust me, your benefit is for planet Earth, but the benefit of God is for eternal purpose. God wants you to get them saved. God wants you to introduce Jesus to them. God wants you to become a light to them. God wants you to become the scripture that they will read. That's why. Who is your brother? Well, how the enemy to define who our brother is. Anyone that needs your love and care is your brother. Can I hear loud amen? Number two, it is those ones whose life is endangered. Those that their life is endangered. That's your brother. They risk, their life is in risk. If nothing is done, they are going to lose their life. If nothing is done, they are going to find themselves in hell. That's your brother. The people that their lives is in danger. Hallelujah. That's who your brother and your neighbor is. I am not your brother. I've been found. Your brother is the one that is in need of care and love. Those of us here that are members of this church and are born again, we are not your brothers. We are co-ministers. But our brother is that one that is in need. And it takes our love to bring them out from the pit and introduce them to the Savior, the only one that can save and rescue their soul. So our brother is the one whose life is endangered. May you loud amen. Are you following? Oh, I prayed for you that God will speak to your heart. Oh, I pray that God will make you know him. Oh, I pray that the eyes of your understanding will be enlightened. That you might know and understand the purpose of his calling. The purpose of your life. Your life is not just for butter and bread. It's more than butter and bread. The reason why you are existing, the reason why you are still alive, is more than butter and bread. Is that God wants to use you as his workshop, workmanship. To do good works. To spread the gospel. That is good news. That's why you are here. So blow my mind every time we ask for newcomers and no one. You have one, two, and I look at the number of people here. I says, God. God says, no. You didn't teach them. You didn't tell them how important this is to me. For most of them, they think life is about them. You didn't tell them that they are my workmanship created in Christ Jesus for every good work. You didn't tell them that I'm going to ask them of their brother. Ezekiel says, if I say to the wicked, thou must surely die, and thou givest him no warning to save his soul, the wicked shall die, but I will require his blood from your hand. Why? Because you are his brother. That's what the Bible says. Ezekiel chapter 3, verse 27, verse 17 to 19 to 21. When I say to the wicked, you must die. And you that is his brother or his sister, and you give them no warning to save their soul. He says the wicked will die. But I will require his blood from your hand. Do you know how many blood God is going to require from your hand? How many blood? Who is your brother? Is that person that is lost? That has not yet found their way to Christ. They are still wallowing in darkness. They've not come to the light of Jesus Christ. If they die today, they're going to hell. There's no purgatory. The scripture records is appointed unto man once to die. There's no repentance in the grave. If these ones die without knowing Christ, they're gone forever. They are doomed. But God says, I love them so well. It's not my will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It's never my will. And that's why I'm making you my workmanship for good works. And you are saying, God, not no, not me. Don't count me in. I'm so busy doing my own thing. God, I'm too busy. My life is just complex by itself. How much more me begins to talk to people to receive Jesus Christ? I'm too dignified to do such a job. And God says, no. My son was super dignified. It was God. He had to take the form of man to carry out this mission. Talk less of you. Are you created as his workmanship? Or are you just living your life? Come to church, we look cute. We look good. There are several thousands of people that will die today and they will go to hell. And some of them we have come in contact with, but we did not rescue them. And God says, I will ask them from you. Oh man, that inexcusable. Where is your brother? That person that your neighbor in your street that has not known Christ, have you attempted to shine the light of Christ to them? Or do you just assume they will not hear you? The survey that was done, it says 4% of people that come to church maybe because they saw advert. But 79% of people that comes to church, they come to church because someone told them, come, let's go to our church. 87%, and you are one of them. And that's what the Bible says, how would they hear without their preacher? How would they go without being sent? And God says, I've made you my workmanship. I'm counting on you. Sister Stella, I'm counting on you. Brother Joe, I'm counting on you. I'm in heaven, but I'm counting on you to rescue these people. He says, no, God. I'm too busy. What? Am I my brother's keeper? Am I my brother's keeper? What is your brother? Where is your brother? And the fourth of who your brother is that one that is wounded by life. There's so many people that life has wounded. They have the wound, they have scar from life. And no one wants to come close to them. Can you make such your brother? Of course that one is your brother. Amen. Luke chapter 10. Jesus beginning to define who a brother is. In fact, I love lawyers. We have some of them here. Smart people. They know how to ask questions. And every tough question that Jesus has ever been asked is asked by a lawyer. And so when a lawyer is asking Jesus a question, pay attention because it's key. They know how to twist the question to get something out of him. And I'm sure Jesus loved lawyers asking him questions. So this is a lawyer asking Jesus a question. And look at what it says. It says, let's go. Are you there? He said, behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? You have been talking about eternal life. You have been talking about heaven. What shall I do to enter eternal life, to enter into this heaven? And look at what Jesus answered. And he said unto him, what is written in the law? How readest thou? You are a lawyer. What is written in the law? And he answered and says, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might, or all your strength, and with all your mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he says unto him, thou hast answered right. This do. Amen. Amen. And thou shalt live. But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Because this guy knew for a fact that everyone around him is settled them. You know that? His brothers, he's taking care of them, gives them money every morning. His sisters, he settles them, send money to them. He's settled his, everyone around him. He's giving them something. He's making them settled. Like we do. And so he was going to justify himself and says, well, your neighbor is your brother. He said, oh, I send money to them. I take care of it. I pay their rent. He says, no. Jesus says, you know what? I'm going to tell you who your neighbor is. And he says, I'll tell you a story. So there's a man that was actually journeying to Jerusalem. Is that Jerusalem? And he fell among thieves. And he was robbed. And they left him for dead. They left him for dead. Hallelujah. And this man, he did not actually specify where this guy is from. Because your neighbor can come from anywhere. What is your neighbor? Where is he from? Doesn't matter. What qualifies him being your neighbor is his condition. Am I communicating here? What qualifies that guy from being a neighbor to any of those guys that came in contact with him was his condition. And what is the condition? He fell among robbers. He was robbed of everything he had and left for dead. And the priest, Fountain of Grace members, just left prayer meeting. And God was awesome. Oh, Caleb and the choir sang their heart out. The glory of the Lord was all over the place. They were so charged up, still in that mountain of fantasy, of religious fantasy. And they saw this guy. And they checked him out. He doesn't look like a member of Fountain of Grace. And they, oh God. Bro, on our service today, we pray for people like you. The Lord help you. They walked away. They walked away. Why? He's not a member of a church. In fact, he's not a member of Christ. No, he's not. The priest would have connected with him. He's not a member of the church. He's a vagabond. He's a sinner. He's someone that has no bearing. He's someone you can't even relate with. So passing him by, there's no consequence when it comes to consequence in the eyes of men, but great consequence in the eyes of our Maker. And the Levite guy came in and looked at him. I said, oh, since I've prayed for you, the Lord will be with you. But the Samaritan, remember the Samaritan woman? I'll talk about that next week. Hopefully, as the Lord will permit. A Samaritan saw this guy. A Samaritan, not a religious person, or a lover of God, a workmanship, because he had an understanding of the scripture that says, whosoever lendeth to the poor, lendeth to his maker, and obtains favor. He had the understanding that anyone that wins a soul is wise. He had the understanding that the soul winning, the soul winner, gives joy to heaven and rejoicing to heaven. He knows that when this man is found, oh, there's going to be a rejoicing in heaven. He may not have the glory, but heaven is going to rejoice over his life. And he says, I'm going to do something. By the way, this guy was going somewhere. He wasn't just roaming about the street. He was a businessman going somewhere. Oh, because of the call of God, he suspended his agenda and make sure the agenda of heaven comes first. Why? It's a workmanship. It's not just a vocational Christian. It's a called Christian. A marine is always a marine. You don't need the uniform to be a marine. A Christian is always a Christian. You don't need a gathering of believers to be it. You don't need us to call a service for soul winning for you to be a soul winner. Lover of God, they are always lovers of God. It doesn't matter. This man terminated and put a hold to his agenda and his business and carried this man. He did not know him from Adam. He doesn't really know whether the people that attacked him will come and attack him. He risked his life. Every soul winner is a risk taker. And that's why God always defends them. Carried this man. Took him to the hospital. And told the doctor. Thank God. I'm sure that hospital is a Nigerian hospital. It's only in Nigeria that somebody's dying. They want money first. If you don't give us money, we're not treating. Wicked souls. Am I communicating here? What did Nigeria do me today? This is the last one I'm talking about, Nigeria. Ugh. And it says, please pay attention. He says, treat him. This is all the money I have. Take. I will come back. The cause of this man is my cause. I'm not going to let him go. So if some of us will just pay the money and walk away. But this is not the guy. This is man that is made, created in a workmanship. He's a workmanship of our Lord Jesus Christ. Created in Christ Jesus. What would Jesus do? He came back and says, anything that is owed, I'll pay back. So Jesus was asking, see, now he now says to the guy, who is this guy's neighbor? Is the one that cares for him. You are not a neighbor till you meet the need of the needy. How concerned are you with soul winning? Easter is coming. And we're going to celebrate. Who are we celebrating? The death of Jesus? Who did he die for? Are we concerned about the people he died for? How come we celebrate him and we're not concerned about the people he died for? What hypocrisy is that? Celebrating him. And the people he died for, we don't care about them. Isaiah chapter 61. Verse 1. Try and close with this. Are you getting something out of this? It's our year of righteousness. So every message you will hear in this church, almost this year, will be the one that will build you to be able to stand before your Almighty Father. If you pay attention to these messages, I can guarantee you heaven. I can guarantee you heaven when you do what the Word of God is saying to you. If you can keep to it and walk with it, I guarantee you heaven. I am not prepared to give you chocolate and buttermeat messages. I am not ready. I have told God I am not ready for that this year. I am not ready for that this year. I am here to prepare you because I know He's coming very soon. I know it. If you don't know it, if you don't believe it, I believe it. It's coming very soon. So my responsibility, one responsibility, is to prep you for the coming of the Lord and constantly remind you that Jesus is coming very soon. You that steal no more. You that fornicate no more. You that commits adultery, don't do it again. Because the Master is coming. And it's coming for a glorious church. A church without wrinkle, without spot. That's what it's coming for. How prepared are you? How prepared are we as a church? What is our commitment? What is our focus? Are we so focused with the things of the world? Are we so focused with our popularity and the things that concern the Father? We're not focused on it. What's your concern? Psalm Isaiah chapter 61. 61 verse 1. Oh, Jesus. And the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the good tidings unto the meek. You know who is the meek? The downcast. You know who is the meek? The one that really, really need love. You know who is the meek? The one that no one will care about. You know who is the meek? The one that thinks he's very rich, but we know they are blind because they don't have Jesus. We know where they're going to. Those are the meek. Those are the ones that Satan actually is messing up your life. They're under the bondage of sin, and sin is having dominion over them. It's our responsibility as the church of Jesus Christ to carry out that mission of His. He says, my mission is to preach to the meek good tidings. So He has sent me to bind the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to them that are in captivity. Guess what? Everyone that is not saved, they are in captivity of hell. Can I say something to you? There's no other name through which anyone can be saved. Only Jesus. The Muslim will not go to heaven except they repent. It is Jesus and nothing more, nothing less. I say this to you so know that good people don't go to heaven. The only people that goes to heaven is forgiven people. And it's your responsibility to drive men and women to the cross where they can ask for forgiveness and they can be welcomed in. That's what Jesus says. He said, come. The reason why I'm here is just to heal the brokenhearted. You set the captive free. The greatest desire, God's greatest desire for man is in twofold. First, that we might find Him by discovering our purpose and understanding. And that we might have an understanding of the seasons. That's our worship. Another greatest desire of God is by loving and showing compassion to who our neighbor is, and that is our reasonable service. Can I hear loud amen? Amen. Proverbs chapter 11 verse 30. It says, he that the fruit of the righteous is the tree of life, and he that winneth his soul is wise. This is our year of righteousness. It says, the fruit of the righteous. The fruit of the righteous is what? Is the tree of life. And it qualifies what that tree of life is. It says, he that winneth the soul is wise. How many souls have you won this year? How many have you invited in the morning to church? you have taken time out and says, I want this one to come. I strongly believe Pastor George, God will give him a message to speak to this person's heart. I would do everything just to make this one come to church. If you are that one that you don't know how to preach, I don't know what to say to them. I'm not like Pastor George, Pastor Sam, or all the pastors. I'm not like Pastor Uche. I'm not like Pastor Gloria. I'm not like Pastor Emilia, Pastor Thomas. I'm not like them. I don't know the scripture. But you have one thing to do. You can be the woman of the Samaritan woman. Come and see. And you walk all the village to Jesus. You don't have to preach. Just bring them here. Just bring them here. Look at what the Amplified version says. The fruit of the consistent righteous is the tree of life. And he who is wise capture and win soul. For God he gathered them for what? Eternity. God gathers them because you are wise and you win soul. And God is gathering them for eternity in heaven. End with this. Who is Jesus? We've seen his mission, right? The Spirit of God is upon me. He's appointed me to what? To preach the good tidings to the meek, to heal the brokenhearted, to set the captive free. That is his what? That is his motto. That is his blueprint. That is what he's called to do. Matthew chapter 1. His name shall be called Jesus, for he shall what? Save his people from their sin. That's all. That's his purpose. And that's why Jesus always, when you ask him, he says, my meat, I know what my purpose is. When they wanted to make him king, he says, don't make me king. I'm here to save the lost. And look at Matthew chapter 16 from verse, let me go back there again. Our guest speaker actually talked about it. But let me just touch it a little bit. From verse 13. And Jesus came to, let's look at it from verse number 14. And they said unto him, some say thou art John the Baptist, some say you are Elijah, some says you are Jeremiah, others says one of the prophets. Jesus came and says, who do people say that I am? You can't follow well till you know who you are following. How come you get it? You can't follow. That's why there are so many Christians that they're not following Jesus. They're coming to church, but they're not following Jesus. The only time you can follow Christ properly is if you know his mission. And many church folks, including church members of Fountain of Grace, don't know his mission. They just think we congregate in Fountain of Grace. And the choir sings. And we pray. And we hear what? And we go, what is the mission of Christ? So he says, I want to know it, because you can't follow me if you don't understand my mission. So what there are people saying that I am, and they begin to say this, they say that, they say that. He said, okay, but what do you say? Who do you say that I am? Because you cannot follow well till you know what you are following. You know why people are not winning soul? They don't know Jesus. Can't follow Christ and not be a soul winner. It's impossible. You can't truly follow him without winning soul. You can't. What did he tell them? He says, follow me. I will make you. The only thing I will make you is fishers of men. Your following me makes me make you. So if you are not fishing for men, you are not following. Simple as that. I'm a follower of Jesus. I'm a follower. No. Where is your fruit? Hereby my Father is glorified that you bear fruit. That's when my Father knows you are following me. When you begin to bear fruit. Am I communicating here? Let's be the church of God. And let God be a place where people congregate. I'm sick and tired of it. I want fruit unto righteousness. I want us to be this place that people come and lives are transformed Not where we come and congregate and see how beautiful we dress and how good we look and how prosperous we've been in the past week with different cars and different homes. Great! But the key is that this is a hospital ground. This is a labor room where souls are bet. It's supposed to be. But you are the midwives that God is saying, I want to use you as my workmanship. Some of you are saying, God, I'm on vacation right now. Please go to Pastor Thomas. I'm not ready now. I'm getting married next week. I'm not ready now. God says, you says what? Think about it. What do men? So what? Who do you? And Peter bowed. You are Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus says, flesh and blood has not revealed to you, but my Father. Upon this rock. Hello? That Christ, what does that mean? What does that word Christ mean? What Christ simply means is Isaiah 61 verse 1. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Christ is the sent one, is the one that liberates men, is set the captive free. What Peter did was to affirm Isaiah 61. And Jesus now says, upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. Upon which rock? Upon the rock of delivery of souls. Upon the rock of saving men. It says, when the church becomes a ground of salvation, then the gate of hell cannot prevail. Because every church that is built by Christ grows. Not by people switching church, but by souls getting saved. Church, I'm sick and tired of recycling believers. Let's get people saved. Get them baptized. Get them to heaven. That's when we become the church. That place is the Father. If the mission of Jesus, we don't have time. John chapter 9 verse 4. My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish it. As the Father sent me, so sent I you. Who are we? We are the what? Of what? Who are we? We are what? The body of Christ. Christ is what? The head of the body. It is cancerous. When the body does not follow the leading of the head. And that's why the church is lacking in healing, deliverance, and every miracle. And you're saying, oh, we need the days of the apostle. The days of the apostle, they were rightly following their master. Why come to get here? It's not magic. When the body is in alignment with the head, there's nowhere the body cannot get to. There's no gate of hell that can withstand the body. But when the body is contradicting the mission of the head, the body is on its own. It will be a headless body that people trample. Jesus said to them, Luke chapter 22, verse 35. He said, when I sent you to go preach, did you lack anything? They say, no, sir. No, sir. No, sir. So winners never lack. They never lack. So winners. They are dangerously protected by God. Never lack. You know why you're lacking? You have not engaged the head of your body. If you choose to engage the head, you'll be amazed. He said, when I sent you guys, did you like? He says, when they were going, he says, make sure you don't take pause. You know what I mean? Every time you go on his mission, you don't have to provide for yourself. He provides. The one that sends you must care for you now. Have you seen an American government sending the troop and will not care for them? How much more God? The only message he's sending you is soul winning. He that winneth soul is wise. So those that does not win soul, they are foolish. That's what the Bible says. Simple. As I read the Bible. How many foolish people are here looking at me? Today you will not be foolish. Yeah. That amen is not born again. Yeah. This is the word of God. He that winneth a soul is wise. Why they have become the tree of life. Let's not be a church that congregate. Count, I will resign if we become the same church that congregate and we're playing games with ourselves and there's no transformation of life, then we may as well close this church and find something else to do. Church is not, you know why you come here on Sunday? It's for me to equip you so that you go win soul. How frustrating it is when I equip you and you don't win soul. The fivefold ministry, the assignment is the equipping of the saint for the work of the ministry. It is the saint that does the work of the ministry. My job, our job here as pastors and evangelists is to equip you to do the work. It is sheep that begat sheep. You do the work. He that winneth soul is wise. When I sent you, did you lack anything? He says, no, sir. The only thing that moves God is soul. I'll talk about the benefit tomorrow, next week. If we are the head, sorry, if we are the body of Christ, we must stick to his mission. Matthew chapter 1, verse 20, 21. His name shall be called Jesus. He shall save his people from their sin. That's his mission. His mission is to save people. For this cause, I'm manifested to destroy all the works of Satan. For this purpose, was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy all the works of Satan, including sin, in the life of people. And if you're not doing it, you're just saying, I'm detached from the head. I'm on my own. No wonder you're suffering. No wonder it looks as if your prayer is not going anywhere. Because you are not connected to the head. I've never seen a body leading himself. Have you seen a body leading himself? It is the head that leads the body. Anybody that leads himself without the head will crash. Jesus is our head. If he says his purpose is for salvation of soul, it is not the will of God that any should perish, but that all, including your neighbors, including the witch and wizard, including the idol worshippers, including the homosexuals, all should be saved. All should be saved. That's the will of God. That's the plan of God. That's why you are here. That's why it says he has made you his workmanship. You have made his workman. He called you in. He said, the one that he know is predestined. by his workmanship. He wants to use you for your neighbor. Think about it. We have 168 hours in a week. The best some of us here are giving to God is 2 hours. That's what we spend in church. If we stay too long, 2 hours. That's the best. Some of you here. 2 hours. The best. Any believer that spends 2 hours in worship of God is not serving God. It takes more than 2 hours. 168 hours. You can't give God 10 hours in a week. Dividing your hours every week. Say 1 hour every week, I'm going to win, look for a soul. I'm going to look for somebody I'm going to minister to. I'm not just going there because pastor say. I'm going there because I am part of the body and he is the head. And the mission of the head is for soul winning. That's why I'm going. You go in there and win souls. It gives you utterance. When a man is willing, he says, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the fat of the land. Who's here? I said, pastor, count me in. I told the Lord in my retreat, I said, I'm sorry. I'm repenting. I am repenting. I love him so much. I'm repenting. Oh, I'm repenting. Can you see Jesus crying? Have you seen him cry? Have you seen him cry? Have you seen him cry for the souls of those he loved? And he looks down and looks at the church infighting. We concern ourselves over petty things. This greet me, this did not greet me. This call me, this did not call me. There are thousands of people that die and go to hell. There's no repentance in the grave, they are doomed forever. The same people Jesus died for. You don't know the God we're dealing with. There's no compromise with him. There's no compromise with him. It's his will or the highway. Revelation chapter 21, chapter 20, verse 20, 15. He said, I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. From chapter 20, from verse number 1. I know we don't preach this in the church anymore, but it's still in the Bible. It's still in the Bible. Give it to me, please. I want to awaken your soul. I pray that God will set your soul on fire for him. That's my prayer for you, that God will set your soul. For some of you that I know you by name, I called your name over the past 3 days. That God, as you set me on fire, set them on fire. Set this place on fire. Men that love God and are passionate for him. They're ready to sacrifice their own life for the cause of Jesus Christ. So I saw a great white throne and him that sat upon it, from whose face the earth. You see this earth that we're gathering, everything that we're gathering? Look at what is happening. Look at what will happen to this earth. You see all this pursuit that we're pursuing? This is what will happen to it. It may not be too long. I don't know when. But I know for facts, because I've had dreams and vision, getting seeing God positioning the angels to blow the trump. So that those of us that are awake and alive in Christ will be raptured. Then this will begin to tick time, will begin to run. Set a motion for God's final wrath upon the earth and those people that are children of disobedience, even though they come to church. It says, and I saw the white throne and him that sat upon it, from whose face the earth and the heavens flee away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. The books were opened, the books of sin were opened, and another book, one book, was opened, which is the book of life. My prayer is, every one of you, your name will be in this book of life. It's one book. I strive every day to make sure my name is there. Because what shall it profit me? Doing all the things I've done these years, and only to hear him say, get out from me, you workers of iniquity, because you have done your own thing and you have not obeyed my voice. Give it to me, please. Don't take my picture away from this. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. Your work, your works. Workmanship. What is your works? Piling things for this earth that will pass away, or you are investing in eternal life? What is your work? 20, give it to me in the next verse. And the sea gave up the dead which were in them, and death and hell delivered the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their work, and death and hell was cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever name was not found written, he's the one that rises, not pastors, not Sunday school teachers. That's why I fear him. I fear him. To what him, God, anything you want me to do, I'll do. Please, God, tell me. Every time I'm wrong, tell me. Don't let me go for too long without stopping me. If you have to break my head, break it and stop me. This is not the will of God that people will go to hell. It's counting on you to go out there and rescue souls. Remind me this story. Small and great, small children. 7, 10, 8 years old. They are going. Small children. I saw small and great. They stand before God. And the books were open. Open the book of fornication, they see your name there. They open the book of lying, your name is there. They open the name of book of deceit, your name is there. Whosoever name was not found written in the book of life. How can my name be written in the book of life? By you accepting Jesus as your Lord and your Savior and walking consciously, following him to detail, making the Bible your guide, and making him your Lord and your Savior, the master of your life. It's to him I owe my life. Nothing. Paul says, what can separate us from the love of God? Only the two are tackled. First, what I call is that if you are not sure your name is in the book of life, he is here, he can write it today. This whosoever name was not found in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire, which is the second death. There is two death for a sinner. Church, we live in a time that the truth is scarce. I love you guys so much. I love you guys so much. You don't know how much I love you guys and pray for you guys, that your faith will not fail you. I will always be in the very will of God, at the center of his will, and asking his kingdom come over us as we walk this journey, that he himself will be glorified in our lives. When that time comes, I will stand before him. All we're going to hear is, thou faithful, thou good and faithful servant. What makes us good is our ability to obey him with everything we have. So if you're not sure your name is written in the book of life, your name can be written today. God can write your name there today if you can give your life to great Jesus and make him not only your Savior but your Lord, the one that directs what you do. As we all stand, if you in the lobby also stand, Pastor George, I'm not sure if my name is written in the book of life. I'll tell you what bites me, kills me inside of me every time. I'll be honest with you guys. I have a senior brother. I used to have a senior brother. He's long been dead. I cannot for a fact. Every time I look, I see his face. My question is, God, did he make it? I know he never believed. Every time I share the word with him those days, he never believed. But I love him so much. I don't know if I'm going to see him again. There is a heaven, there is a hell. All eyes bow, all eyes closed. Pastor, I'm not too sure if my name is written in the book of life. Can you just lift up your hand? And I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to walk you through. Can you just do that, please? All eyes bow, all eyes closed. If you are not sure that your name is written in the Lamb book of life, can I see your hand up? No movement. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, my sisters. I want to make a commitment to God, not to man, but to God. And says, Jesus, I will follow you. I will walk with you. I will obey you. You own my life. I owe my life to you. I give you my life. Forgive all my sins. I repent of them all. Lord, forgive my sins. I'm sorry for everything I've done wrong. I repent. I receive you as my Lord. I receive you as my Savior. Lord, help me to walk with you as I trust my life to your hands. Write my name in the book of life. And I promise you, Lord, that I will never disappoint you. I will live for you. I will walk with you. In the name of Jesus.
Thank you for watching. For more information, please visit us at Fountain of Grace, 427 Turnpike Street, Canton, Massachusetts, 02021. Or give us a call at 781-821-1121. Or feel free to give us an email at admin@fountainofgracebos.org or visit us at our website at www.fogbos.org. bos.org.